You know, I imagine back in 1953 when this car came out and you bought one, you probably thought, well, cars can't get much better than this. You got 3-speed with overdrive. It's smooth. It's powerful. It handles nice. It's got a heater. It's got a radio. I mean, this is living the American dream. What an episode of Jay Leno's Garage, Pandemic Edition. This is the second time we're in lockdown. Remember, we did a bunch of these pandemic ones, then the crew came back and we shot a whole bunch of those. But then they came in again and said, no, you can't do it anymore. So we're back again doing the Pandemic Edition one. So thanks for sticking with us through these. We certainly appreciate it. The car we're featuring today, 1953 Hudson Hornet Coupe, I guess. This is the one, you know, they did do a sort of what they call a California top looking one with the no post, but I like this. This is the rigid one. This is the one that kind of won stock car fame. These are legendary cars in the 50s. It had the classic step down design. I'll show you a couple of Hudson posters I have, not posters, paintings that we did. We put them on the wall in the next building. I'll take a look and you'll see what's meant by the step down design, where the car is lower than the frame. You literally step into a Hudson. You know, most cars from this era, the early 50s, the roof was up to here, you know, but this is actually much lower. And these won all kinds of races with the Hudson Hornet twin H power, 2 1 barrel carburetors on a 308 cubic inch 6-cylinder engine. The most powerful 6-cylinder engine in America at the time, if I don't know if the world necessarily, but certainly one of the best, and a wonderful, wonderful motor. The thing that killed Hudson was they didn't develop a V8. They stuck with the 6, and the 6 made plenty of horsepower. In fact, this is 170 horsepower when I believe the Rocket 88 Oldsmobile, which was the motor. Remember, Cadillac had the overhead valves in 49. But for the working man, the Hudson Rocket 88, that was the engine, V8 overhead valves. That was, I think, 165 horsepower. It actually had more. In fact, I wish I could find it. I have a very funny video that used to run in Hudson dealerships. It wasn't a video. It was like a reel of tape, and it was silent. And it shows a guy standing by his Hudson, you know, and they have right next to the Oldsmobile Rocket 88, and the hood is up on the Rocket 88, and the customer is going, when is my car going to be ready? And the mechanic's going, these overhead valves, Mr. Johnson, they're very hard to adjust. I can't, well, fix that thing, you know. And then they pan over to the Hudson, and the guy is just torquing the flathead engine. The customer's like, oh, well, that didn't take long at all. That's right, Bob, these side valve engines, you don't have, you know, why the side valve was superior to the overhead valve, which, of course, it is not. But it was a kind of a fruitless attempt to keep something going. You know, it was a classic case of the last days of old technology are better than the first days of new technology, and it might have been true at the time. Anyway, these handled, and still handle very well. You know, I like this era of American automobiles because it just barely predates power steering and power brakes. So everything is nicely weighted, nicely balanced. You know, you can feel the road under you. It shifts. You know, you feel it go through the gears. They're just wonderful driving cars. And Hudson was the stock car king in the 50s because they handled. And they used to say, you may get us on the straights, but we'll get you in the curves, because these were lower, and with a lower center of gravity, they handled better. I had one when I was in college. I bought one in, what's that by that? It's in, I guess in 69, I think I paid $400 for it. I love my Hudson Hornet. And it got stolen in front of 1754 Commonwealth Avenue in Boston. And I went out one day and it was just gone, you know. Every couple of days I would go down to the yard, to see if the cops had found it. You know, this one cop said, no, I haven't found it. Okay. So almost every day I was going to this impound yard. Did my car turn up? No, it didn't turn up yet. And there was a cop in the background, kept giving me the eye, you know. I'm like, what's that? You know, so I went in one day, and the guy I usually saw was busy, and I saw this guy, and I said, were you trying to tell me something? And he said, yeah, listen, that guy wants your car. It's in the back of the impound lot. If it stays here for 60 days, he can buy it, you know, as unclaimed property. So you don't tell him I told you that. So He came back, and anyway, I got my car back. So that was kind of nice. I appreciated that policeman helped me out. And then one thing led to another, and I went to California, and of course the car got sold, and I always miss it. So when I got here, well, I've had this one about 25 years. This was a nice original car. This had 15,000 miles on it when I got it. So a nice unmolested example. It just sat for a long time. We restored it. It's pretty much as it left the factory. It's not a resto mod. We haven't done anything to it. It's a three-speed with overdrive. It's got the center post, which I like. It's a very rigid car, very comfortable car to drive. These are just wonderful automobiles. And they were sort of, I guess you'd call it the mid-price field, maybe equal to Oldsmobile or Buick, certainly not in Cadillac territory, but a lot of people thought they rode better than the Cadillac. They were very comfortable cars. And this was the first sort of new car of the post-war era, you know. When the war ended, General Motors and Ford and everybody else, they were still doing warmed up, or warmed over, I guess is the term, versions of the pre-war cars, the 41, the 42 Cadillac and everything. And the 46 and 47 looked like, wasn't until 49, 50 they started coming out with the really new stuff. But Hudson was ahead of the game with their sleek styling, you know. The Hornet series ran from about, I think, what was it, 51 to 54. And this is the one that really made them famous in the four-door and two-door version. I have a four-door also. That's another story. Let's open the hood and show you what we got here. Take a look at this big twin H power. Ooh, 2-1 barrels. Yes, sir, Bob. Let me open that. Well, there you have it. There's your twin H power right there, 2-1 barrels. And of course, the gold engine, that's what they did. 308 cubic inch, 6 volt electrics. We haven't really changed anything, a more modern radiator cap. Other than that, this is pretty much the way it left. This just required cleaning up, painting, re-chroming, new rubber, new gaskets, because it had sat, and it had sat for, 30 years, something like that, when I got it. Yeah, this is just the way it is. You see the way the works the windshield wipers. He's got this wire here. Nothing fancy here. Easy to work on, easy to service. You know, that's what's nice about these things will run forever. They're just fantastic cars. All kinds of interesting touches. There's a light in here that lights up. It says Hudson at night. Yeah, just really neat. I put an alternator on it, a 6-volt alternator, just because you want to have bright lights and you want the radio to work. You know, a lot of times with these old 6-volt systems, when you slow down the radio, it just goes down and your lights go dim and you rev it up and it comes back up again. But with a 6-volt alternator, it really keeps, you can keep the original all the 6-volt wiring. You know, a lot of times guys will convert it to 12-volt, but they don't change the wire. People forget there's 6-volt wire and there's 12-volt wire. And 6-volt wire is much thicker. And when you put a 12-volt system with 6-volt wire, you get something less than desirable, put it that way. That was about the only change, our 6-volt alternator. And they're available. I do need engine mounts on this. I ordered them and thought that they would be in by this time, but they haven't come in yet. So there's a slight vibration from the old engine mounts. But I just put a bolt through it to hold it. You see the engine, it's rubber mounted. And these have a bolt to go through it to secure it. And what happened was the rubber is deteriorated and the bolt fell out or got lost or whatever. We put that in there. But other than that, she's fine. This fake hood scoop, I think, was new for 53. I love the split windshield. The nice thing is, if you get a chip in your windshield, I don't have to replace the whole thing. You know, it's funny to me. This looks like a sort of an Audi TT. It almost looks fairly modern compared to the stuff that was around the 50s from the other companies. They were kind of angular and not aerodynamic, whereas this has a smooth look, I think, that holds up very, very well. It still looks somewhat contemporary. You know, it's funny, sometimes with designs, you have to wait 20 years to decide whether it's still relevant. Like to me, I always try to sneak my F1 McLaren into these videos. That car could be built today. Exact same design, doesn't look dated. Countach looks dated. Some other cars look dated, obviously 59 Cadillacs, things like that. Whereas this is just, the proportions are nice. It's aerodynamic, it's smooth. There's nothing garish about it. Maybe a bit too much chrome for most people, but I don't mind that. Come on, let's go around the back of the vehicle and take a look at that. I like this big 1 pound of chrome stuck on here, this big thing that says Hornet. It just makes me laugh. And of course, there's all this stainless steel trim here, nicely done. Proper bumpers. And of course, you got twin H power. Let's take a look at the trunk. And a good sized trunk in this thing. These were real family cars. Let's take a look. Got a couple of suitcases in there. Put a couple of guys in here. Everything you need to change a tire, no stupid little can of air that goes, you know, those don't work. You got a proper spare right here. That's all the original material from the trunk. I love the Hudson exhaust tip. It says Hudson right on there. Come on, let's take a look at the inside. As you can see, this cabin is a nice place to be. I don't think any, at least American manufacturer, had interiors as beautiful as the Hudson. I mean, nice materials here. Look at the door. Chrome on the dashboard. Just a nice place to be. I like the weather control, it says here. Like, you don't just turn on, you actually control the weather. I like that idea. But it's a huge heater. And these old tube radios, you know, you turn them on, they and they warm up and they have a deep, rich bass sound to them. I mean, look at all the chrome in this thing. Boy, it's amazing. Good sized glove compartment. You got your Hudson owner's manual service policy. Okay. There you go. Special notice, read carefully. You know, Hudson was a department store in Detroit. And he was one of the people behind funding the company. So they named it after it, after Hudson Department. So some decals there and some other things. It's fun to have all this original stuff. What else can we show you? Oh, your antenna up here, you control that. Turn that, of course. But everything, look at the chrome. I mean, they just do a nice job. And this was not a crazy expensive car. This was, like I said, a medium to slightly higher than that price car, but not in the, certainly in Cadillac or even Buick range. So, and Hudson was quite successful. The trouble was, as I said earlier, they didn't develop a V8 fast enough. You know, GM was gangbusters in performance and eventually just drove the independents out of the market. Hudson merged with Nash Calvinator to become American Motors, and that's what happened. That's what happened to Hudson. But not many independents survived after World War II. You know, at one point, General Motors had something like 52% of the market, and the government thought, oh, we got to break this up. They've got a monopoly, much like Henry Ford had had. But like all monopolies, it doesn't last. The Japanese came along and knocked that out of the box. And so you just sort of let the free market handle things the way they do, I guess. I love the way the numerals are. I'm not sure what you call that type of script, but it's quite handsome. It's quite attractive, easy to read. This is just a nice driving car because it's that era when before, as I said earlier, before power accessories. So you just sort of, there's a nice weight to the brake, there's a nice weight to the steering. It's a little heavy parking, But on the road, it gives tremendous road feel. I mean, these are very nice driving cars. You know, the myth of all 50s cars being big wallowing boats going down the road. Not with Hudson. These were, I think, sports cars probably being a bit too generous. But they handle very nice. And when we put this up on the lift in just a minute, you'll see one of the cool features. I'll show you something that even probably guys that had Hudsons didn't know about, in the fact that you have hydraulic brakes, but you also have a backup mechanical system. You have rods that go back to the rear wheels, or I guess it's a strong wire. Well, you'll see when I put it up on there, that should the hydraulics fail, that will stop you. So that's a pretty cool safety feature. What else? That's sort of the cork inserts that go on the clutch. I mean, there's a lot of old, don't forget, this is 1953, so you've got a lot of technology from the 20s and 30s in here. But by this point, the side valve engine had been developed, and it was smooth, it was reliable, pretty much bulletproof. You know, if you find one of these engines in a field, God, you can clean it up and get it running in probably half a day, you know, because there's not a lot to them. It's basic, simple technology. And this 308 cubic inch engine was powerful. You know, six cylinders, we don't give it the respect in this country that it has in Europe and in England. But you know, all diesels usually are six cylinders because all your power going in a straight line, I think that gives you more torque. Maybe that's one of those old wives' tales, but I think it's true. It's the reason most trucks use a big straight six, because you get more torque and more power with it. It's certainly true with this. I mean, I think if you didn't know and got in, you would think this was a small V8. It's a big motor, 308 cubic inches. But let's start it up. We'll take it next door and we'll put it up on the lift. Here, you can hear it run. Once she warms up, she'll smooth out. If there's a bit of rocking, it's because that motor mount is sort of, as I said, is bolted down, the rubber's gone on it. That will be replaced very quickly. Come on, let's take it next door. Here are those posters I was talking about, or the paintings, I should say. What I do is I take the original Hudson ad and then I put my car in it. See, that's the car we're dealing with right now, the 53. There it is right there. But here's what I was talking about. Here's the step-down design. Can you see the way the frame is lower? You see the way the car is lower than the frame, actually? See how the frame goes around the entire car? It's not a unibody. There's an actual, what do they call that, a perimeter frame, I think is what you call it. But if you kind of study that for a minute, it gives you an idea of why the center of gravity is so low and why it handles so well. Because, see, the floor is below the frame. Most cars, you sit on the frame, whereas this, it's about 6 inches lower. So just one of those kind of interesting fun facts. But come on, let's put it up on the lift and show you what I'm talking about. Okay, we got the Hudson up on our sterile Coney lifts here. I've got my iPhone, as you can see. Well, the muffler is probably 25 years old. That's when we put it on. Stays pretty nice under here. Let me show you what I was talking about with the brakes. You have a mechanical backup to the hydraulic system, okay? Okay, here's your hydraulic brake right here. Now, should this fail, you see, this here is connected to the brake pedal. It'll pull this, which pulls these two levers, which run to the back brakes, and that will give you, that's my hand, that will give you emergency braking if the hydraulic system fails completely. You've got the mechanical backup. So that's pretty cool. Now see, this is, I guess you call this semi-unibody. Is that what you call it? This unbolts, this whole front end can unbolt. As you can see here, the places where it's lower than the actual frame. That's the step-through design. Once again, there's the hydraulic brakes. And then this here, see it? The brake will pull this here, which pulls this back, which It's true. That's really the definition of an emergency brake, because that's what it is. If that fails, you've got an emergency. Here's the front end here. As you can see, we've cleaned it up and done some work over the years. This restoration is at least 25 years old, if not more. I've had this thing for quite a while. You've got some cork inserts in the clutch, kind of a lot of old school stuff here, but reliable, dependable, best handling car of the early 50s. Okay, thought you might get a kick out of seeing some of that. Let's take it for a ride. You know, I imagine back in 1953 when this car came out and you bought one, you probably thought, well, cars can't get much better than this. You got three speed with overdrive. It's smooth, it's powerful, it handles nice, it's got a heater, it's got a radio. I mean, this was living the American dream. See, that shifts into overdrive. I just like the amount of road feel you get from this era. Let me put this window up so it doesn't affect the audio. Here we go. See how nice and quiet it is in here. Obviously, side valve engines don't rev, but you can't beat them for smoothness and torque and just ease of maintenance, you know? I mean, just unbolt the head, scrape it, clean it, put a new head gasket on, you're ready to go, you know? You could overhaul one of these engines in a day, no problem. See, I just get just a trace of, oh, but it shifts, look at that. Ugh, like butter, un burro. Nicely. I think this thing was the equal of the Rocket 88 back in the day. You know, when you read the old magazines, you always read about stoplight drag races or guys in Hudson blow the doors off to the guys with the fancy V8s. You know, they're funny. A company named Clifford used to make all kinds of high-performance options for the Hudson, you know, aluminum cylinder heads, stuff like that. But just so easy to work on. Generator, starter motor, pop it out, pop a new one in. I mean, just so easy to work on. I like a big steering wheel. This makes me laugh. I feel like you're 7 years old sitting in your dad's lap driving this thing. As I said, I had one of these when I was in college and I was just kind of getting started as a comedian and stuff. And from Boston to the Catskill Mountains was about, I don't know, 6 hour drive, something like that, and take the Hudson, drive all the way up there to make $25, and then drive all the way back again. But you know, it did it. You know what helped a lot was certainly the Cars movie, the Pixar movie, you know, with Doc Hudson and all that. I mean, really put this car on the map, because little kids never paid attention till that movie came out. Then I would drive this somewhere and kids would run up and ask if it was the car from the movie, you know, what, you know? But yeah, that was pretty neat. This is a good car to drive during the pandemic, you know? You don't look like some rich idiot pulling up. Like I always, you know, I always see these guys with Lamborghinis with open exhaust, you know, and they look like deposed dictators' idiot sons driving around annoying people, you know? When you drive something like this, people come up and they're friendly and they smile and they ask questions and want to know what it is. And Hudson, what? I never heard of that. But Hudson was a major manufacturer up until the 50s. You know, around 1916, 1970, there was something like 350 automobile manufacturers in America. Some legitimate, some not. Most would just buy an engine and assemble a car and call it the Johnson or whatever it is. There are a lot of major ones in there too. And I think every year since, we've lost probably 5 or 6% every year since the 20s. Another one would go out of business. In my lifetime, of course, you've seen Buick disappear, Oldsmobile disappear, Saturn, all of those companies. And of course, Hudson, which became American Motors. I've got another Hudson, a 51, a four-door. That one we put air conditioning in, upgraded a little bit, but still kept the basic bones of the car, you know? It's not something I want to put an LS1 or something in because this ruins the whole character of the car. To me, it's fun to drive it the way it was intended back in the day. And it does a good job. You know, I'm not a sports guy, so I don't know what the analogy would be. Maybe, you know, I know a lot of friends of mine, they get the old vintage uniforms for their teams, whatever, Red Sox, Patriots, whatever it might be. And that's what they do. Yeah, and that's kind of what this is, you know. It's a sort of a different era, a different time. But, you know, you can drive a car like this today. Gets good gas mileage. It's easy to work on. Insurance rates are low. When I was a kid, junkyards were filled with cars like this. Not most of them, but a lot of them running, and you could drive them away for $50, but now everything just gets crushed and recycled right away, which is kind of sad. I mean, it pulls so nicely in second gear. Look at that. Overdrive is one of the things that just disappeared. Most modern cars, the overdrive is built into the automatic transmission, but back in the day, it was a whole separate deal. You could turn it on or shut it off. That's the knob right here under the dash. The reason you turn off overdrive is when you're going down like a steep hill so you don't wear out your brakes, because brake fade was one of those things that was a big problem back in the early 50s. The brakes would get so hot they'd lose all their power, and you'd use it, so you want the transmission to help you slow down. Like this thing, when I get on a steep grade, I just shut off the overdrive so it stays in gear. So you use engine braking to help you get down the hill. But you put your foot in, look at that, Coach, look at that. I mean, I think most people would think this is a V8 if they were riding in it for the first time. But I would drive this anywhere. You know, I'd take it to San Diego or someplace a couple of hundred miles away because it is pretty bulletproof. I mean, it's reliable. You know, you can still get cars like this at a pretty reasonable rate. And the nice thing is, if you're new to the old car hobby, these are perfect because parts are still readily available. Cars are relatively inexpensive. They're easy to work on. You don't have to be a master mechanic. Just almost any garage tools will get you through. I think in one ad they have 8 people in this with 4 across the front. And I see how that's possible. But you know, even a corner like this, a sweeper, you know, any other car in the 50s, you'd really be thrown against this door and the tires would be screeching. Whereas this thing handles and drives just wonderfully. I'm doing 70 miles an hour and I'm having a normal conversation with you. So there you go. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this little trip back to a simpler time. And this was a simpler car, you know, and easy to work on, fun to drive. Good looking. Hey, what more could you ask for? Stay safe, everybody. Hopefully this pandemic will end soon. And I'll see you guys next week. Thanks. Mm-hmm.